My advice to a junior or about to be senior in high school is go to the cheapest school possible to get your freshman and maybe sophomore classes. You don't need to go to Harvard. Harvard, you know, introduction to writing and freshman English and freshman sociology. Okay, you can make an argument it's going to be better than, you know, Joe Blow Junior College or community college. But the reality is you have to weigh that against if you're paying for your school or, more importantly, if you're borrowing money for your school. Do you want to be saddled with $40,000, $50,000, $80,000, $100,000 in debt? I'll give up, you know, the incremental value of freshman English at a great school to not have the stress, you know, just physically on you and your family. My advice, general advice, is assuming there's not just the bills you got to pay that are just enormous, is you paid all that money to learn. Now here's your chance to get paid to learn. And you don't need the perfect job. You need to get a job where you can make some money, but also where you can learn and add it to your portfolio of knowledge, add it to your foundation, because as much as we want to think that we know exactly what our mission in life is and what our chosen profession is going to be at 22, hell no. There's just no chance that the 30-year-old or even the 25-year-old is going to look back at the 21 or 22-year-old you and say, oh, that dude had it all together and knew exactly what was up, right? He's going to look back and go, beer pong, what were you thinking, you know? And so don't expect to have all the answers and don't try to get the perfect job. Go out there and get paid to have different experiences, and it's okay to jump from job to job if it's not the right job. You are getting paid to learn. Flip it and then use that to build your knowledge and learn more about yourself, learn how to learn in business, and see where it can take you.
Don't use credit cards. Of all the investments you'll ever make, paying 19%, or, you know, or 18% on something is easily the dumbest. That's money that you should be keeping. You can be saving. It's a different world now because you can be a smart consumer. You know, you have the ability to price check anything on Amazon or Walmart.com, and you know what you need to save for, put on layaway with them now. And ended up, I had so many credit cards cut up. I was cleaning up some stuff and saw my old credit report. Sears, Amex, Visa, Kaufman's, these old, the situation I was in was like anybody who would give me a credit card, I would use because I didn't have any money, so I needed to use it. And so I literally there, someone's flipping the old chunks of my old credit card somewhere. So, you know, stay away from credit.
Depends how much money you have, right? So the best way to get a return, let's just say you have $50,000 in cash. It could be 10, it could be 100, but, you know, let's use 50. First thing I would do is pay off all your credit cards because that's costing you 18%. That's what John and Sally should do first. Most don't, right? There's more credit card and student loan debt relative to personal income than there's ever been in the history of the United States. Second thing you do is you use the transactional value of cash. A lot of people say, you know, you're losing money to inflation when you just have cash in the bank. I completely disagree. I know I'm going to be buying a bunch of toothpaste for my family. I know toilet paper. I know all the consumables that I have. I can take my cash and go get a better value. I can take my cash and go buy services.
Store up?
Yeah. Yeah, why not? I mean, how much space does toothpaste take, you know, but you're going to spend. But that's the whole thing. The time it takes just to figure out your budget, which nobody does. The time it takes just to analyze your spending habits, you can get a better return and you'll end up with more cash than trying to fight the John Paulsons of the world and these guys who have hundreds of analysts who are working for them. Why would you try to do better than them?
You can't win.
You can't. And now it's 100 times worse because of all the program trading. So, you know, back in 2006 and 2007, I was writing blogs saying, look, the stock market's for suckers. You're getting put, you know, when you sit down at the business table, you always look for the sucker. And if you don't see it, it's you. And you've got all these professional people on the other side of the trades. I mean, when I started trading stocks in the early 90s after I sold my first company, you know, you could understand different elements of the market better than the professionals. So I can understand, you know, new technology from Wellfleet and Synoptics and all these old technology companies better than the traders. Today, there's so much money in these huge hedge funds, and then they have such professional research and in-depth research, there really aren't any advantages for the individual traders. And so my approach has always been, unless I know something specific, put it in cash. You know what I do? I don't think you have to make a return on it, because I'd rather sleep well at night. You know, I put it in cash, literally. Now, obviously, I'm in a different position where I don't have to live off of the interest paying me one basis point off of cash, right? But at the same time, having that dry powder, if you will, available when weeks like today or weeks like this week hit and days like yesterday and today
happen. And you see an opportunity,
then you're ready to take it, as opposed to saying, I can't get out. What am I going to do? And I'll tell you the other part that's better. You're going to cut your health costs because you're going to sleep a whole lot better.